Tanya Jamie Nelson, born Pyong Thao Nguyen, was born in 1964 in Vietnam. She was the youngest of 16 children and came from a family who had a lot of money. In 1979, when Tanya was 15 years old, her whole family moved from Vietnam and settled in Orange County, California, in a heavily populated Vietnamese town. She finished high school, graduating from Costa Mesa High School, and after graduating, she started a relationship with a man and had her first child. The two ended up splitting, and shortly after, Tanya met and married a man by the name of Jonathan Nguyen. The married couple ended up having three children together, and they were all initially living happily under one roof. Things were going well as Tanya had started her own lingerie company in 1998, as well as an undercover escort business. Her family was living in Little Saigon, and Tanya met a woman by the name of Ha Jade Smith, who was living her life as a fortune teller for the Vietnamese community. There were many fortune tellers in this area, but Ha Jade was considered top dog and built up such a reputation that some clients would pay her up to $15,000 in cash as payment for their fortune being told. Many of her clients depended on her not only for advice, but to curse loved ones and or enemies, for lucky numbers, love spells, and more. Ha Jade always dressed lavishly, drove expensive cars, and was not afraid to flaunt her wealth. She drove a nice Mercedes-Benz and was always adorned with fancy jewelry. Her house had actually been robbed a few times, but this did not stop her from living life how she wanted to. She took some precautions by hiding large amounts of money in odd places like food containers and even her vacuum cleaner bag. She had a 23-year-old daughter by the name of Anita Nivo, who was attending college and, although not in the same business as her mother, still lived at home with her. As for Tanya and her lingerie business, the success slowly began to fade, and by March of 2000, Tanya and Jonathan were over $200,000 in debt from loans and credit card debt, so they ended up filing for bankruptcy. Tanya ran to none other than the infamous Ha Jade for advice on what she should do with her failing business in Little Saigon. During their session, Ha Jade suggested that Tanya move her business to North Carolina and let her know that she would be much more successful there as opposed to staying in Little Saigon. Wholeheartedly believing in Ha Jade, Tanya, with her four children, moved from Orange County to North Carolina to continue her business venture over there. She opened up her sex toy / lingerie store in a conservative North Carolina town right next to a church. Jonathan stayed behind in California, but the two were not officially separated. Jonathan would visit Tanya twice a year, but unbeknownst to her husband, she was having an affair with her brother-in-law, his biological brother, Lloyd. Tanya initially met Lloyd when the family would take trips to Vietnam. He was much younger than Tanya, but when he became a legal adult, she seduced him, and the two began their affair. She then pressured her husband into sponsoring a visa for Lloyd so that he could be closer to them, and once Lloyd moved to the United States, they continued their affair, and throughout the years, Tanya would go to Ha Jade for love spells. As Lloyd got older and matured, he realized that having an affair with his sister-in-law was not okay, so he moved to North Carolina to get away from Tanya. So when Tanya met with Ha Jade asking for advice on what to do with her business, she brought up North Carolina first. When Tanya first made the move to North Carolina to be with Lloyd, he fell back into her trap and the two actually bought a house together. Tanya felt that Ha Jade's fortune was coming true and she was initially happy. Time went on and Lloyd once again came to his senses. Tanya did not want to divorce her husband Jonathan, and Lloyd felt that he needed to get as far away from Tanya as possible. He ended up moving to Georgia and breaking things off with Tanya for good. To make his move from her official, he began dating someone else, and the two eventually married. This angered Tanya, so she took a trip back to Orange County to meet with Ha Jade. She requested a love spell to win Lloyd back, but for the first time, Ha Jade refused. This time, she gave friendly advice and said that Tanya should get over him and move on. This infuriated Tanya, so she left and began her violent rampage. She told Lloyd that she was going to take his fiancé at the time, cut off her fingers, and mail them to him. She then took a trip to Georgia after finding out where the fiancé lived and using spray paint, sprayed profanities on the house along with the sentence, "Lover boy, run before she sucks you dry." After Lloyd married, Tanya hired a private investigator to follow Lloyd's wife, and one day when they were away from the house, Tanya broke in order to steal items, including a photo album of the married couple. She broke in another time and turned on all of the sinks, which caused the couple's house to flood. While Tanya was spending so much time focusing on Lloyd, she was not focusing on her business, which was beginning to fail, just like it did in California. She was unable to pay her mortgage and lost her house. She reached out to Hajade a few more times, and by February of 2005, instead of talking on the phone or meeting in person, Hajade sent Tanya a note that said, "Sorry, I cannot do this for you." Tanya's demands for curses and spells became too much and unreasonable for Hajade to fulfill. Tanya's anger shifted from her ex-lover to Hajade. She blamed Hajade for her failing business, her failed relationship with Lloyd, and the overall decline in her success. Over the years, Tanya had paid Hajade a lot of money, so her mind was set on revenge and getting the money back she felt that she deserved. Tanya then enlisted the help of a Vietnamese man who knew no English, Philippe Zamora. Philippe was a married man who, in his own words, had a subservient relationship with Tanya, and he did everything she asked. Tanya knew that Philippe was secretly gay, so she used that to her advantage. She communicated with Philippe her plans of hurting Hajade in Orange County. Initially, he refused, but she convinced him by telling him that she knew many gay men and she would hook him up with these men in California for sex. Philippe finally agreed, and the two traveled to Orange County. On April 20th, 2005, they had lunch and went over their plans, although Philippe later claimed that he did not know anything was going to happen until the day of the murder. The following day, on April 21st, 2005, on the pretense of only having a reading done, Hajade agreed to give her longtime customer a reading. The reading went well, and Tanya communicated with Hajade that she wanted to celebrate the success to come. She requested that Hajade call Anita home so she could say goodbye. Hajade agreed, and Anita thought nothing of it because she had known Tanya for many years. Once Anita made it home, they had champagne, and according to Philippe, out of nowhere, Tanya shouted for him to grab a knife. He grabbed a knife and proceeded to stab Hajade in the kitchen. Anita tried to escape and made it to the hallway, but Tanya, who had also grabbed a knife, caught Anita and proceeded to stab her to death. The family dog was in the backyard barking, and Tanya demanded that Philippe kill the dog, but he refused. He later said in court that he could not bring himself to kill the dog because he was not a murderer. After killing Anita and Hajade, the two started to clean the house, but they also ransacked the house, stealing anything of value. They eventually left and went to Walmart and bought white paint because it was the least expensive, and then drove back to the crime scene. Hajade's head was face down, and it's been documented that her body was positioned into a yoga pose with her knees bent and hair laid to one side. Her hands were then covered in white paint. Philippe had the job of doing the same thing to Anita, but she was lying face up. Philippe said that he could not bear to look at her face, so he pulled her shirt over her face and then covered her face with white paint. The paint ended up drying, leaving the paint-covered shirt stuck to Anita's face. The two then left, with many valuables, but missed the $500,000 in cash that was hidden in Hajade's coffee maker and vacuum cleaner. After leaving the crime scene, that same day, Anita's on-and-off-again boyfriend, Yun Tran, paid the house a visit. He wanted to rekindle his relationship with Anita, so he left treats on their doorstep. He returned the following day, and he noticed the treats he left the day before were still there, and that was very unusual. He decided to call the Westminster Police Department to do a welfare checkup on them, and upon entering the home, they discovered the crime scene. Back in 2001, Hajade was captured and robbed of $372,000, so they initially assumed it could have been a similar situation. They saw that the house was ransacked and they found a plastic bag that contained two bloody knives. They assumed the suspects intended to discard the knives, but lost them while looking for things to steal. The knives were tested for DNA and there were multiple profiles. Anita and Hajade's DNA matched, but they also had one other sample, but unfortunately there was no match in their system. Philippe's DNA was the one on the knife, and he later went on record to say that the only reason why Tanya's DNA was not left behind was because she was wearing gloves and had also washed the knife she used. She tried her best to cover her tracks and even took a shower, but she ended up leaving a bare footprint on the bathroom mat that contained Anita's blood. Police eventually discovered Hajade's appointment book and saw that there was an appointment scheduled on the day of the murder with Tanya. They were now on the hunt for Tanya, who had actually stolen all of Hajade's credit cards and had used them to purchase flight tickets back home and for a vacation using Hajade's Louis Vuitton bags as her luggage. She spent over $3,000 on her vacation and thought the money was rightfully hers. A month had passed and Tanya felt that she had gotten away with the perfect murder. She ended up getting sloppy and bought a brand new car with a cash advance from Hajade's account. The police ultimately busted Tanya in a hotel room on May 30th, 2005 after tracking a credit card purchase of a flight ticket. They were able to link Philippe to the crime because he was on the receipt for the flight ticket home. After obtaining a search warrant, police searched Tanya's home and they found an appointment book, and once they checked the date for April 21st, 2005, there were the words, "Horrible sin." Philippe was arrested shortly after, but he immediately confessed, leaving Tanya feeling betrayed once again. Trial began years later in 2010, with Judge Frank F. Faisal presiding over the case. Philippe pled not guilty, agreed to testify against Tanya, and he always cooperated. He testified for 2 days out of the trial with a Vietnamese interpreter, and he also admitted that he was interested in the gay sex partners and was willing to help Tanya, but did not know there was going to be a double murder that day. Tanya, on the other hand, was said to have been very difficult with her lawyers, sometimes refused to even come out of her cell, and would even yell and shout during trial. Other days, she sat motionless with a stone-cold face, not saying a word. During the victim's impact statements read by Hajade's sisters Nikki and Huang, Tanya turned her back towards them and never made any eye contact with them. Tanya and Philippe were both found guilty of 2 felony counts of second-degree murder. Philippe was sentenced to 25 years to life in prison, and the death penalty was taken off the table for his cooperation with the investigation. The deal was that if he lied or was not completely honest any time during trial, they would add time to his sentence, and that ended up happening, so a prosecutor recommended that 2 years be added to his sentence, and the judge agreed. Because of that, his sentence was changed to 27 years to life. On April 23, 2010, Tanya was sentenced to death, making her the second woman from Orange County to ever be sentenced to be executed. Tanya was sent to the Central California Women's Facility in Chowchilla on May 3, 2010 at the age of 55, and that is where she is currently being held. Men who get sentenced to death in California get sent to San Quentin. As for what Tanya has been up to on death row, she changed her faith from Buddhism to Christianity and is serving as an evangelist for the other female death row inmates.